Herb's over there. For the story.
Herb's over there like, okay, I gotta turn your headphones up, guys. All right. Okay, so moving on. Johnny, you got a chance to play Xenoblade Chronicles 2.
Yep.
Electric Boogaloo.
Electric Boogaloo.
All right, give us the lowdown, man. What's going on?
All right, so this is a sequel to a game that came out on the Wii many years ago. Fantastic, amazing, amazing game. So this is a JRPG where you're playing as this character called Rex, and you live on the back of this small titan that flies you around, and the world that you inhabit, and there's other cities and whatnot in this world, all of which is on the backs of titans. So what you have is this world that's filled with clouds everywhere. They call it the Cloud Sea because it's like the ocean.
I really thought you were going to say Cloud City.
The Cloud Sea, because it's basically an ocean filled with clouds. And
all right, we got to work on your delivery, man. It's like, the Cloud Sea, the ocean was clouds as far as the eye could imagine.
Yes.
You have to paint us a word picture.
And the land masses are these giant titans, massive, massive titans.
Epic land
that are either walking
of titanic
proportions. Or flying. They're either walking or flying through the Cloud Sea. And
they ambulate or they soar majestically.
Yes, they soar majestically. And that's how the land masses and the continents of this world sort of takes place. So picture like if Australia, the continent of Australia, mm-hmm. is on the back of this big giant giraffe titan.
Spiders as big as giraffes.
Look, man, I've read Discworld, and I know that the world is just on the back of a turtle held up by four elephants.
Yep. Yep.
So.
Yep.
I feel like I'm ready for this game.
There's all these different titans, many different titans. So each titan kind of represents a country, a civilization. And there are multiple countries, multiple civilizations. And they're at sort of feuding with one another because the titans that they live off of and live on top of, mm-hmm. they're dying off. So the land is literally dying. So it actually opens up with that at the very, very beginning where you see one of the titans sort of die and dive into the sea. And, you know, the main character makes comment like, oh, I hope no one was living on that titan.
That right? giant landmass that the we all giant... know is populated heavily?
Yes. And that sort of sets the tone where this world is not sort of an indefinite thing and you're the characters that live within this world, they hold these titans precious, right? Because without it, they can't live. They'll end up succumbing to the underneath of the Cloud Sea. So that has you as this character sort of going through this story that eventually leads to a better long-term solution for this problematic world that everyone lives in. And part of the...
You can make the world better, harder, faster, and stronger.
Yeah. And part of the problem is that...
Well, Johnny, you got to work it harder.
I'm working really hard, man.
Do it faster. I'm sorry.
So...
No, I'm sorry. More than ever.
Yeah, so the problem is that these different countries, right? They end up warring with one another because the resources are very limited. And that sort of creates this global conflict that takes place first at the background and then at the forefront as your character is and their traveling party members are sort of working their way towards and understanding more and more of the world. And your role within it becomes that much more important.
I feel like this isn't a quick arcade beat 'em up.
No. This is a 100-hour-long... JRPG romp.
Wait, why do you sound disappointed? Herb's like, ah. Wait, you wanted like a Titan one-on-one fighting game, didn't you?
Of course,
Godzilla style. All right, to be fair, that does sound kind of badass.
Well, so they make Godzilla look like a regular sort of animal that would live on a Titan. That's how big the Titans are.
So Godzilla.
No. They make new Godzilla look like it's
living... not new Godzilla. Oh. New Godzilla.
No, I
every
I
single
that,
form of Godzilla would live on just one Titan. That's how big they are.
Big.
Okay, that is pretty big.
That's just silly.
They are absolutely massive. So they have, like, entire cities living on these things. So as you're playing through the game, you're exploring and you're going on to these very different titans, and each titan has like very different worlds. You're not only just living on the back or run around on the back of it or on its wingspan or whatever, you're also inside of the titans too. There's entire civilizations that are taking place inside of a titan as they sort of have cities inside of them and people sort of live off of what's inside of them. So that's sort of the world and a little bit of the story there. And then there's this
civilization and society on top of a giant thing that they live in from within and then they exist on without. The whole thing is very existential, man. Continue.
And it's all it wouldn't be a good JRPG without a fantastic combat system to it. And this is most JRPGs kind of fall in line with like a turn-based combat system, but this is a real-time combat system. But instead of hitting buttons to attack every single time, so instead of it being a very action-oriented real-time combat system, it's a more strategic and tactical, very much a tactical real-time combat system where your character will auto-attack, kind of like how World of Warcraft, that combat system is, where your characters will auto-attack, and then you start doing your better attacks, they're called arts, doing your more powerful attacks with special abilities associated with them, and those would have cooldowns associated with them, so you're interweaving those types of attacks and special attacks in between your auto attacks in order to sort of get into it. And that's just like the slightest skimming that's like the tip of a very, very big iceberg when it comes to the combat. It is
Don't give us the connotation, man. You know, delve deep.
I don't know if I have enough time to delve as far deep.
Delve deep.
To put it in perspective, the combat system, they keep teaching you and giving you new combat gameplay mechanics until the very end of this game. So you're learning and getting new combat enhancements until the very end of this game.
Well, it's kind of like a tenet of RPGs, isn't it? Because the more you level up, the different abilities are unlocked. It's like they've been teasing you this whole time. You're going to be able to do this.
Right, you know this? Right.
Oh, remember that thing you saw on the box cover? You can do this too.
It just keeps on compounding with itself. So one of the big mechanics is you have these blades and they're very important to the story and to the combat system and everything. So you yourself, your character and the party members, you're all drivers, and drivers have companions called blades, and blades sort of give their abilities to the driver in order for the driver to be better in combat. And what you are doing in combat is you're building up these blade combos by doing special attacks that add elements to the enemy that you're attacking. And then once these elements are built up in a certain way, you end up executing on this blade combo that does massive damage. So it's very layered. And then also the drivers themselves, they have their own way of doing combos between themselves. So you're fluctuating between doing driver combos, blade combos, and then when you're doing them both and they're overlapping at the same time, you get this thing called fusion combos.
Oh shit.
So it gets really deep, really fast. Oh, I wouldn't want to say fast, because it does ease you into each of the intricacies of it.
See, that's the stuff that I always look for, because sometimes when you have to take care of a lot of stuff at once, I get very like, what am I doing?
Yeah, they will strip away a couple of things right from the start, and then as you're playing, you know, for 1 hour, they'll show you a bunch of stuff, and then for the next hour, they'll show you a bunch of stuff, and that goes on for like the first 20 to 30 hours of the game, where you're slowly learning more and more intricacies. It's, like I said, 100-hour long game.
Okay, so when you said that 100 hours, you meant the whole game is one fight, and it's just really working everything into like the mechanics of one hit, and then you're going to defend once, and then you're going to strike back. Game over.
Yeah, this is across multiple combat sessions, multiple boss encounters, multiple sort of elements in the story. You're easing into this as you're going along, and it holds your hand pretty well. So you're not going to get overwhelmed if you play this from the start. What I will say is, if you watch someone play this while they're midway through the story,
you're going to be like, happening?
It's going to look bonkers crazy. But if you play from the start, it all makes sense. It all explains itself pretty well. You'll know what attack canceling is, what driver art canceling is, and all that. And each of these characters...
What check canceling is.
Sounds like stereo.
What dinner order number three canceling is.
I know a lot of people who are really into this, the game series itself.
This one takes the complexities of Xenoblade Chronicles and really ups the ante in just about every single way. Because the big thing that made the first one so fantastic was that a lot of these different systems, they all played well with one another, and there was sort of this synergy between your relationship between your own party members with different townsfolk, and that sort of enhances other aspects like combat and stuff like that. And that's all in this game. And then they take that up to 11, where you can, every single city that's in here has its own economy, and you can help develop that economy by doing quests, interacting with NPCs, by spending money, by buying things, by selling them things, by doing these mercenary quests, side quests that you don't actually do. You send your blades off to do stuff for you. It's really, really intricate and so many different layers of depth. And there's always going to be something.
And this is good, right? Because it sounds like, and there was an element of Assassin's Creed Black Flag, which should have been cool, but I think the way they actually enacted it, it was just kind of lame, where you're doing all this cool pirate stuff in the main game, and then you're building your own armada on the side. But when you actually use that armada, there's the occasional fight to get a new ship or defend your ships. But besides that, you have to send them on missions to collect like resources and stuff. And then it's all like, it becomes paperwork in the video game. It sounds like stops for like a good 10 minutes each time. It sounds like this is what you're describing here.
There is some of that paperwork element, but they work it well into how it doesn't take too much of your time. It will take a lot of your time if you want to invest your time into doing something like this. It's not necessary except for a couple of storyline elements where it is, but even then, it's not required for the vast majority. But if you do invest your time into it, which isn't too much, but over the grand scheme of 100 hours, you're going to be spending a lot of time on the mercenary stuff and other aspects. It rewards you for it. So, and it's also what you do is you just go into a menu, you send your whatever blade you want off to a mercenary quest, and then that will take anywhere between 20 minutes to an hour, and then they come back. So you send them off, they come back, and you reap the rewards, and that's pretty much what it is.
And you're not micromanaging them, you just go back, done.
You're not, but you can, and if you, most likely you will, because you want to be in that kind of involved.
That sort of overbearing a-hole.
There's also a element of Pokemon in this game, where you're cracking open these crystal cores that give you new blades, and I don't even want to get into that, but there's so many different aspects, it's impossible for me to sort of fully cover everything that's in this game.
Well, you already said 100 plus hours gameplay.
So. Yeah.
And you perked up a second when you mentioned the crystal cores. Is this a good thing?
No, just the term crystal core got me thinking about Crystal Chronicles from Final Fantasy. This is totally, my brain's just thinking cute Moogles, guys. You can ignore me.
You have to carry the crystal.
Yeah. In my head, all I'm picturing is like a little Moogle with a bucket right now. And I'm like, oh, I miss that game.
Very different interpretations. All I'm hearing right now is you have designed like a Hermes Conrad mode for this.
Hermes Conrad mode.
Hermes Conrad. You ever watch Futurama?
No.
He's the bureaucrat that's very happy about being a bureaucrat. And that's all I'm hearing. It's a game where you can do a lot of cool stuff over here, but over here, guess who's micromanaging y'all?
I'd say it's got like little elements of like Civilization or SimCity kind of stuff, because you're helping build up the economies. There's like a lot of little things that all sort of feed into one another, and if you spend the time, you'll be rewarded for it. But it's also optional, so it's not even required. The last two things I want to touch on this is first, the music in this game is the best video game music I've heard in years. Mm. Without a doubt, this soundtrack is absolutely
by Green Jelly, everyone.
Fantastic.
Green Jelly. Oh, man.
It's one of the people that made the soundtrack was also one of the original composers to Chrono Trigger.
Oh, yeah, that's good music.
Is that Tom Tallarico?
I forgot the dude's name, but it's one of them. Like, I'm telling you, this soundtrack, I'm very close to thinking it's the best of all time. It's Ooh. That good. It's right. really, really good.
I don't know, man. Earthworm Jim is still up there for me. I'm just saying.
And the last bit about this is the ending. Usually JRPGs get crazy and overboard, and they don't tie things in a nice little bundle at the very end. This one, this is one of the best, not only JRPG ending, but one of the best endings I've experienced in a video game. I cried twice. I don't cry when I play games. I don't.
Yeah, you're not supposed to.
And so...
Only one game, like, ending has ever made me that emotional. And it wasn't even like one of the sequels. It was Metal Gear Solid. Oh. Where after you leave your enemy face down, ass up, on top of a giant mech. And then you just kind of ride out into the snow on the back of a caribou.
That's a really good moment.
It was a really good moment.
That is a really good moment.
And depending on who you saved, you're either with Meryl and you have a very apparently non-canonical happy relationship as you retire from the military. Or re-retire from the military. Or you're with Otacon, your nerdy sidekick. Two of you go off to have random snowy adventures.
I think I read that fic.
I have the book. All right, that's how deep it was. I played the game. I beat the game. I loved the game. I bought the book.
Xenoblade Chronicles, fantastic game. Highly recommend it. It's also an open world game, so I just want to throw it out there. Yeah. People didn't get the gist of it.
An open world RPG?
It's an open world JRPG, yeah. It's fantastic. Okay, absolutely fantastic.
Do you mean open world like open map?
Yeah, open map. It's wild.
Okay, yeah, I went all cross-eyed for a second.
100 hours, Pat.
100 hours.
That's actually short for a JRPG.
That's like the minimum.
Yeah, it actually
took me 116 hours and change to actually beat it, but I did a lot of extra stuff. But you can go way further than what I did.
Johnny's there redesigning character shoelaces.
There is one like absolutely big problem with this I have to point out. It's the voice acting. It is... Some characters are all right.
Is this are we talking English or Japanese?
English.
Okay.
I recommend going with the Japanese. You can download it. It's separate DLC. You can download it for free.
No, do that. Be a purist in anime. Don't be a purist in games.
Why not? What? I never play JRPGs in English dub. Would you do that?
Xenoblade Chronicles actually has one of the best voice acting in video gaming, no question. But this one, they dropped the ball so hard because some of the characters, especially the main character, Rex, just atrocious in dialogue delivery and the lack of emotion. There are scenes where the character is angry, should be angry, and should deliver a very angry,
All I can think of is Kevin Sorbo. Disappointed!
you don't get Mega Man? What am I fighting for?
Oh, man.
Worse than that.
Because I'm imagining it's like, oh my god, we're in trouble. What are we going to do? We must go to...
Kevin Sorbo.
Oh no. There seems to be trouble over on the hill. We must go fight, right?
Dog!
Oh, man.
Okay, all right.
So that's it. Other than the voice acting, the story is actually incredible. So just the voice acting, steer clear of that, and you'll have a very great game. It's already thumbs up.
Yep, all right.
I recommend it.
Yay!
Thumbs up and a half.
All right, this man gives it the highest seal of approval. Remember, we're on the radio. You actually got to say it. He's like, what? I've been done.
He did.
You need to be coaxed. I'm messing up. Coaxed. All right. Xenoblade Chronicles 2, available now for
the Nintendo Switch.
Nintendo Switch. Check it out. Thank you, John.
Which I just bought, which I don't think I have 100 hours, though.
You will not see sunlight for a long, long time. Yeah. All right.
I haven't seen Adam at work for a while.
Someone check his house. It's that smell.
Exactly.
Oh, jeez. Black Adam, you have sacrificed your soul, sir. Forfeit.
Exactly. Exactly.
All right. But no, let's talk about something fun.
Yep.
I mean, not that wasn't fun. But no, I'm talking, of course, about new series on Amazon, Jean-Claude. Yes.